I found this years ago in reading in a missionary magazine about the history of one of the more famous of the African missions. And almost all of their initial people for many years perished within just a few years of their showing up there in Africa. Among their earliest leaders was a man who preached always on one topic. I've heard of one man preaching 20 times on John 3:16 back during the time of D.L. Moody. And I've heard of another man who recently in New York City was preaching on Ephesians 1:18 for a record number of Sundays. Please don't refer me to any book of lists. But then I look at this sermon of this man, his topic, where I never preached was this, was on the conscious, continual communion possibilities between God and man. I once preached at the invitation of a Chinese church in Manhattan years ago. The man who preached before me was bombastic, crazy, really pow, 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 powerful. I got up and followed him and very modestly preached the sermon that I almost always preach when I go someplace for the first time and ask believers there, is your experience one of a conscious, continual communion with Jesus Christ? I know that was very low-key compared to that first sermon, but how important. Because there are so many who claim to be believers in Jesus today who have this absent from their lives and this essential joy, this essential privilege, the presence of God. Why, how do people make it through? And how do Christians make it through without a consciousness of God intimately, personally, each day? I know in our group here, we have a healthy habit, many of us. Many of us, once every month or two, we pick up from Brother Carl, Brother Manfred, and Brother Leroy in the back, a copy of Our Daily Bread. It's good. It's good. But it's not sufficient. Please, let them know in Grand Rapids, Michigan, it is not sufficient. It is not a substitute from a relationship with Jesus Christ yourself, and that every day. And we settle for less, but my first point then of what is the hope of his calling is this, the very presence of God. You know, as long as he is with us, isn't everything good? As long as God is with us, won't everything be well? As long as he is with us, the presence of God, won't there still be joy and victory? Am I hearing tomorrow that I have cancer? Will that mind be deluded by the presence of God? Will that be carryable, that burden, that cross, as I acknowledge that I have God with me and he will be with me through everything? My friends, the presence of God means everything. And it is one of the hopes that are ours as ones who have been called by him. Then my next few points are security and eternal joy. And let's face it, there's no chance of getting to eternal joy today. But in weeks to come, we hope to look at scriptures about the new heaven and the new earth, about what lies ahead for us. But look at security this morning. What a joy it is that, you know, we've got other resources than the national government. You say, well, I hope under the new administration that more of the power will be returned to the states from the national government. Don't have your faith in the state. Watch what's going on in New Jersey right now. Thousands, the governor is threatening to cut off the jobs of people. They thought they had permanent jobs there, but 5,000, and the taxes on this, whole departments of the state government, he's wiping out commerce and agriculture. Woo! Interesting to see what's going to happen. But you know, whenever we put our faith, we put our faith in our own governor, don't do it. Do you remember our governor before he was governor? He was infamous around the country for throwing people who protested against abortion into jail. He took pride in it. If he went after anybody more than he went after the real estate or the Wall Street types, he went after those good people who stood around obeying the law otherwise, outside at a distance from some of these places where abortions take place, and he would take the law and punish them and jail them to the fullest extent of the law. This is our governor right now in New York State. I wouldn't trust that guy any farther than NARS here to throw him. Husky Muscular. Not me. I can't trust the national government. I can't trust my state. My city. I love this city. I can't trust it. But I can trust my God. Let's look at some scriptures about how trustworthy, how he has plans for us. Romans chapter 8, verse 15. Look at Romans, again by Paul here. Chapter 8, and listen to these blessed words. Verse 15, Romans 8, 15. For, says Paul, you have not received the spirit of bondage, again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. One of our missionaries sent us, I don't know where they get the money sometimes, but they did. There were scores of pictures of the orphans raised by this one missionary. Oh, it's John Gladstone and Priscilla. This is a city, I believe, approaching 30 million people. Mumbai is the old Bombay. There are settlement camps in Mumbai. Altogether, I think I read there are approaching 20 million people living in settlement camps in desperate situations in Mumbai. Our brother has a marvelous way that he does it in starting churches and loving orphans. And when I visited, I can still remember 20-some orphans rushing this man, loving him, appreciating him. It was just obvious they loved him. It was wonderful. I'm just honored to pray for John, who's not really technically our missionary. But I remember the latest thing from John was little pictures of so many of these little children. There must have been 40 of them pictured on one page in color. And I thought, oh my. I thought about fathering and being a father for three children myself, all of them in their 20s now. I think the honor of turning to one like I didn't have a chance to when I was a boy. My dad split from home when I was around 12. My friends, affection, a care. You know what? How can you and I doubt a loving father as to whether we are secure in his arms? Whether our future is secure, that he loves us. And that his plan always includes the very best for us. We are his children. Verse 15. We have received the spirit of adoption. This is why we cry out affectionately, Father, Abba, Father. And Paul says, and if children, why, that's even better. We are heirs, H-E-I-R-S, heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ. If so be that we suffer with him, if we go through bad times, that we may also be glorified together. I like those last words. I didn't mention them at all in the last sermon this morning. Implied there is, if times are bad, we're going through it with him. We're together. We are promised bad times. These are not good times. The Bible never encourages us to look at it and to say, oh, the old days were better. The old days were better. Listen, we have enough to worry about to live through the days we got and to be instructed concerning the things God has for us for the future. But there is a God to look forward to experience there. And there's a God who we experience today, and he will never leave us. He will never forsake us. And we are secure in him. We are children of Almighty God. I can't explain to you how mad I have been at certain of my children in the past. Maybe you have felt some of that controlled wrath even your parents have on occasion for you. Hopefully, they never gave vent to it to its fullest possible extent. I remember one of the happiest days of release I had as my kids tormented me, when they were young even. I took them out to the park here in Flushing, where they have a nice ice skating rink inside. I paid for my two girls, it was only the two girls, I paid for the girls to have skates on and to go out there, and I watched them from the side and hid behind a pillar just watching them. And forgive me, this is inside of my character. I laughed and hooted out of their eyesight every time they fell. I just had the most glorious time. I don't know, that release, I'm sure, prevented me from turning physically violent at least a couple times, but it was such a release to see, bam! They never got hurt. Full of goodwill, oh boy, have your children tried you like my children have tried me? Probably. And you still love them, and you wish them the best. And it has never occurred to you to kick them out of your family. One of my children, from birth, I've really wondered whether maybe the nurses didn't mix up the babies. But I've never thought of kicking one of them out of the house or from this relationship. Nor is that the way it is with our God. Have you noticed? We'll see a verse or two of this. They're important. God finishes what he begins. And once he commits himself, he's not backing away. And so in our relationships, and security is about relationships, isn't it? Security is about relationships. And our relationship with our God is secure. Hey, even better, we're closer than we've ever been. We are heirs with Christ, and we are sons and daughters of Almighty God. Into these doors come some of the greatest people imaginable alive today. For they have bowed the knee to this God, imperfect in every way, but in Christ Jesus, precious to him. Look at this same chapter, chapter 8 and verse 29. God's been planning and working this all the time. 8:29 Romans, for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son. He's decided to do this. There's no deferring him or derailing his plan. Please note, I know a great debate among good people. Did you know that even in Baptist churches, people debate some of these verses? Did you know that 100 years ago, every single Baptist church in England believed these things and taught these things with power and energy because they believed these things? But today we prefer not to think or receive something that is absolutely vital. God's in charge. God is in charge. Verse 29, he has foreseen, he's foreknown, he's predestinated to be conformed to the image of his Son, a process that is going on, yes, when he gives a new birth, but is going on until he takes us to glory. And it never says he stops that work. Man may retire, man may be attracted away to the islands for a better life. Hey, our God finds joy in us, in our sanctification, and are we conformed to the image of his Son. And though we're miserable students sometimes, and we're miserable children of his, and he often, must shake our heads, we are so unlike the Savior. His prayer, his hope, his plan is that we be conformed finally to the image of his Son, that Jesus might be the firstborn among many brethren.